Blackstone Audio presents Fiddle Game by Richard A. Thompson. For Bud George, who introduced me to the mystery. Chapter 1. Waiting for the Doe. On the day of the first killing, it rained. Not an easy rain, but the kind of endless, pounding deluge that makes people wonder if they really did throw out that old boat catalog, and if not, whether it listed any arcs. Personally, I gave up looking for arcs a long time ago, the wooden ones or any other kind. I like the rain. Agnes, my secretary, says that's just perversity, liking anything that puts other people in a bad mood. But she isn't always right. Not always. On that particular wet day in 1996, nobody was right. I looked out the streaked glass of my single storefront window, past the neon sign that says 24-hour service backwards, and assessed the prospects of a flash flood. You can tell a lot about a city by what's in its old core downtown. Across the street from me is an old-time resident hotel, long ago gone to seed. There used to be a nightclub on the ground floor under it, but that's been boarded up and closed for longer than anybody remembers. Farther down is a place called Pawn USA, a hole-in-the-wall deli, and a pornographic bookstore. They've all been around long enough to be landmarks. The pawn shop, run by a sometime friend of mine named Nickel Pete Carchetti, just expanded and got its trendy new name, which I suspect came from the title of a textbook on modern economics. Farther down the street lie a Dunn Brothers coffee shop, an upscale tattoo parlor, and a manicure emporium called Big City Nails. Kitty corner across from me stands the newly renovated courthouse, taking up a whole square block, and behind it, connected to it by tunnel, is the county jail. The long fingernails, tribal markings, and she coffee are current hot-ticket items, but I don't expect them to last. The trendy shops come and go. Here in St. Paul, Minnesota, the capital of Midwest niceness, the only really solid growth industries we have are government and crime. Strangely enough, the cops don't have a building in downtown proper, merely one on the fringe of it, though they definitely have a street presence. Maybe that's the way it should be, since they are really just the gatekeepers to the criminal justice system. And if that's the case, then I'm the man in the toll booth. My name is Herman Jackson, and I'm a bail bondsman. Behind me, Agnes sat at her PC clattering keys sporadically. I could tell by the rhythm that it wasn't work-related, but since she is my chief office organizer, accountant, PR expert, and generally indispensable confidant, as well as my secretary, she's entitled to spend her time as she sees fit. The computer was making funny noises, like tinny fanfare or electronic oohs and ahs, and occasionally she would make an ooh of her own. "Video games, pornography, or the stock market?" I asked, without turning around. "Stocks. I don't do games." She said nothing about porn, I noticed. "You should look at this, Herman. Amtech.com is down to 16.5 today. It's a fluke. Has to be." "The market is reacting to news of an outbreak of moldy sow bellies in Kathmandu." Which made exactly as much sense as most of what I hear out of market analysts.
"Seriously, at that price you could make a killing. Double your money in a couple months tops. You could afford to take a little flyer like that now and then, you know. On your latest profit and loss sheet, you showed..."
"I don't gamble, Aggie."
"You gamble on pool."
"That's not gambling, that's social intercourse. I never bet more than 100 on a game, and I never try a double back off the side rail if I've had more than 2 drinks. And if that isn't prudence and self-discipline, I don't know the stuff. And I do. I paid full price for it, and now it's my biggest asset."
"The market's not really gambling either," she said. "It's more like reversible bidding at a garage sale. After all the hype blows away, there's always a real piece of merchandise of some kind there."
"Except when there isn't. How much did you lose on Enron? Isn't that why you're still driving to work in your beat-up Toyota instead of your new Lexus?"
"That's not fair, Herman. People a lot smarter than me got burned in that scam.
And people smarter yet didn't play."
"Like you? Like that time you got arrested for somebody else's homicide and had to liquidate your business in Detroit and run off to the boonies?"
It was her ultimate weapon in any argument.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.